Now, one interesting thing I indicate here where radar, TV, FM, AM radio are. You may not know that in the United States and every other country for that matter, regulates who can use what frequency for what purpose. And here is the United States frequency allocation chart for what you are allowed to do. You can't just go off and make whatever electromagnetic waves you want in space. Now, light, there's not much you can do about, but in terms of the electromagnetic waves extending from a few megahertz up to gigahertz frequencies, and now with cell phones and Wi-Fi and other things, we're doing multi-gigahertz radio waves very routinely. You have to be organized about how you allocate the spectrum, who gets to use it. So if you zoom in here, for example, in the range, let's say 54 to 72 megahertz up there, that's broadcast TV. Channels 2, 3, and 4 are in there. And then you see, well, there's a fixed and mobile, there's 1 megahertz. Then there's a yellow band there for radio astronomy. Nobody's supposed to transmit in 73 megahertz to 74.6 megahertz so that astronomers can look for radio waves coming from distant objects. And that happens to be a frequency that's of interest astronomically. Then we have up above it broadcast TV channels 5 and 6. And then FM starts at 88. When you tune in your FM radio in your car or wherever, goes from 88 to 108, that's 88 megahertz, 88 million cycles per second up to 108. And that whole chunk of the electromagnetic spectrum is reserved for FM radio. And then later on, you see down here, broadcast TV, what we call the UHF, ultra high frequency, is 512 megahertz, channels 21 to 36, et cetera. A lot has changed in the last 10 years with this because we've gone from a system where TV stations broadcast almost solely out over the air and people have antennas on their roof to get their TV signal. We've gone from that to almost everyone has cable instead. So what's happening with these big chunks of the electromagnetic spectrum? Well, a lot of TV stations are still using that broadcasting in digital rather than in analog anymore. But I don't know. We have a big chunk of the electromagnetic spectrum that we probably don't really need to use for broadcast TV anymore. And this is a resource, right? I don't know why it hasn't been taxed in the past, but it certainly could be in the future. It's something we all own and share. And we ought to be taxing it, and we're not. Oh, by the way, I'm an amateur radio person, and the amount of spectrum available to us are these tiny things like 50 to 54. There's another one that you can't see, 146 to 149. There are little slices in different parts of the electromagnetic spectrum. On my roof at home, I have an antenna that can send and receive in the 7 megahertz, or so-called 40 meter range. I can hear people from Vancouver to Mexico and out to Indiana and Hawaii with that radio. It's pretty cool. Anyway, stuff about the speed of light is pretty cool. And I'll come back to this later when we talk about light in detail, but the speed of light is really, really fast. 2.996 times 10 to the 8th meters per second in a vacuum. That means in a billionth of a second it goes about this far, 30 centimeters. Okay? It can go around the Earth 7.5 times in 1 second. Nevertheless, when you look at me, that's not where I am now. That's where I was, you know, a few billionths of a second ago. When you look at the sun in the sky, that's not where the sun is now. That's where the sun was 8 minutes ago. We're 8 light minutes away from the sun, 8.3 minutes. If we try to communicate with Mars, well, it depends on how close or far away Mars is. Anywhere from 3 to 22 minutes. So think about that next time you see a movie about people going to Mars. And, you know, in a movie, they're not going to show you that communication, there's a communication lag of 20 minutes. And it's another famous category of bad movie physics is instant communications with distant objects. A light year is 9.5 × 10^15 meters, okay? Our galaxy is tens of thousands of light years across. Other galaxies are millions of light years away. The observable universe is 10 billion, 13 billion years in size, light years in size. And it could extend beyond what we can see with telescopes. But we're going to come back to light in a big way later in the course. Now, I get plenty of crackpot email from people out there. People hate this idea that there's a cosmic speed limit, right? Einstein was wrong. I get all sorts of emails. I have a folder that I collect all these in with their new theory about how you can actually go faster than light. And of course, science fiction wouldn't be very much fun if you couldn't travel faster than light. But the problem is that the speed of light, this is really weird, is the same. If you measure the speed of light, this is very different from any other medium we're going to talk about in this course. If you're moving toward light, in other words, if there's a source of light and you go toward it and you measure the speed of light, you still get the speed of light, c. It's a constant. If you're moving away from it, you don't see it slow down. It's still the speed of light. That's very weird, and that's what led to Einstein's theory of relativity. Now, like I say, we're not going to deal with relativistic waves in this course. When we have a wave medium like sound, sound is traveling in air. Suppose you have air that's stationary, the sound waves are traveling toward you. If you go toward the source of sound and you try to measure the speed of the wave, it will apparently increase. If you're going at 10 meters per second toward the source of sound, and you measure the speed of that sound coming toward you, it'll appear to be 10 meters per second faster than it would be if you were standing still, and vice versa when you're moving away from it. This also leads to something called the Doppler effect, right? Where if you're moving toward a source of sound, you hear it as having a higher frequency. And that's an artifact of the fact that you're moving relative to the medium. And likewise, if you're moving away from it, or if the source of sound is moving away from you, you hear a lower frequency sound than you would otherwise. So is the speed of light really the ultimate speed? So I say here, number two, nothing can go faster than light. That's an absolute, I'm afraid. It's sort of the way space and time are constructed, as far as we can tell from relativity. So fun as it is to fantasize about faster than light travel, it isn't going to happen. Now, light in a vacuum is constant, but light can slow down when it goes through a medium like glass or water by a certain amount, by a fair amount, in fact. Light slows down in glass by about 50%, okay? And in high refractive index materials, like your glasses probably are, by nearly a factor of two. In diamond, it's 2.25 or something like that. Light, when it hits it, slows down. And that leads to a phenomenon called refraction, which we'll get to in the third lecture. So that's what's coming. There's another kind of wave that I wanted to talk about, which is called a shock wave. Now, you've seen shock waves probably your whole life. Whenever you see a boat go through the water, you see a bow wave, and it's got this characteristic angle to it, right? The faster the boat is going, the more pointy the two waves are coming off the front of the boat. Likewise, with a high-speed supersonic fighter jet or something like that, It produces a shock wave. It actually doesn't come from the tip of the jet, but somewhere near the middle of the fuselage. It produces a shock wave which travels through air at what speed? The speed of sound, right? But if the jet is supersonic, then it's going faster than sound. So your mind starts to go, well, how does that work? Well, it still is putting out, you imagine the jet disturbs the air as it goes by and creates a pulse, all right? And that pulse travels away from the jet at the speed of sound, okay? So if you work it out, what you find is that this pulse has a certain angle with respect to the jet. When the jet was back here at the point of this triangle, you know, a split second ago, and it emanated the wave front traveled forward at the speed of sound, which is slower than the jet, which is going here faster than the speed of sound. As you can see, the line along which the jet is drawn is longer than the line corresponding to V sound times time. V jet times time is a longer thing. But you get a wave front then, which is at a characteristic angle theta, which you can calculate from the speed of sound and the speed of the jet as cosine theta equals V sound over V jet. And you can calculate the same thing for a water shock wave. Yes?
If the jet travels faster than the sound, does that mean the jet would be like gone by the time you hear it?
Yeah. Yeah. But you will see a streak in the sky, and then you're some distance away from the jet, presumably. And so then the sound reaches you well after the jet goes screaming by, and it's quite loud. You can find good demonstrations online of this. I can't get the sound on for you. You see the jet going by, and it's producing that what looks like smoke or haze around it in a cone shape. And that cone is from the shock wave. So it's compressing the air and rarefying it. And what happens is water vapor in the air quickly condenses and then evaporates again. So it's an evaporation wave coming off the jet.